You may proceed whenever you're ready.
Good morning. May it please the court. I'm Jeffrey Wexler. I represent appellants. I'd like to reserve 3 minutes for rebuttal, perhaps optimistically. I'll start my argument by showing that the district court abused its discretion by awarding fees and costs, and that argument will fold in the issue whether the district court erred in granting summary judgment on the scope of rights conveyed by the 1976 agreement. After that, I'll turn to the district court's prejudicial errors in excluding evidence at trial, and then, time permitting, I'll get to the Section 412(2) issue with regard to the award of attorney's fees after the grant of summary judgment.
I'm confused. You're arguing the fees first and last? Two different fees issues.
I'm afraid I'm going to run out of time, so I'm going to get the most important fee issue. And it's well briefed, I think.
Yes, it is. Extensively briefed, anyway. Yes.
Extensively. I like my briefing, but hopefully the court will agree. The district court's award of attorney's fees and full costs should be reversed because the district court committed legal error in analyzing the factors of frivolousness and objective reasonableness. I'll discuss those two factors together because they're pretty much the same. A district court found that UMC's...
What is the difference? I don't understand how you have two things. One's frivolousness and the other one's unreasonableness. What does that mean?
I agree. I mean, it doesn't. The district court found that there is some distinction in that frivolous means it's basically beyond the pale. There's no way that anybody could make this argument. And objective reasonableness more, did you have a realistic chance of winning?
Well, then you should just have the unreasonable standard. And what do you need frivolous to? It doesn't make sense. But go ahead.
I agree. And the district court, you know, made kind of inconsistent findings on frivolousness and objective reasonableness. The district court found that UMZ's position was not frivolous, as the term is used in the case law, but then it went on to find that the factor of frivolousness...
Well, that's not quite right. The district judge said it wasn't entirely frivolous. Okay. Here's the problem. Let me just cut to my view of the fee issue. Fogarty line of cases, first of all, the statute gives the district court broad discretion, which the Fogarty case has confirmed, to award fees. This is a holistic inquiry, okay? This is not a granular, strictly defined test of frivolousness. Judge Berzon's question shows why. You can't really draw hard lines in this overall assessment of whether fees should be shifted or not. So what I found troubling in your brief is you're kind of going down to the atomic level when the inquiry for the shifting of fees is not at that level at all. It is the district court's sound discretion, in light of everything he has seen happen, decide whether you should pay the bill. You don't have to be utterly frivolous or completely objectively unreasonable to get fees. You just have to, the district court just has to conclude that overall this was a bad case. That's it. That's what Fogarty says. I'm putting it a little bit more glibly, but that's what Fogarty says. What is wrong with that?
Well, VMG Valsal says that the district court's error in evaluating objective reasonableness can justify overturning the award of fees.
But he didn't make an error here. He said, I'm not declaring this to be objectively unreasonable, but I have my doubts. That's perfectly legitimate for a district judge to say. I have my doubts. I don't think this was a very good case. And taking into account everything else, that tips me in the direction of fees. I cannot see any abuse of discretion in this.
Well, he was wrong as to the issue on which he apparently found objective unreasonableness, if he did, or frivolousness, which is the scope of rights conveyed by the 1976 agreement. The district court, in making its summary judgment ruling, relied upon a statute.
I'm sorry to jump in. I'll let you talk in a minute, but this is another issue. You know, you're trying to smuggle in a review of summary judgment in a fee context, and that's just not right. We do not need to reach the merits of the summary judgment order, which arguably were completely trumped by the verdict anyway, to decide on fees. Those are apple and oranges issues.
I respectfully disagree, Your Honor. There were two issues in the case. One issue was the one that went to trial, which was whether or not the 1976 agreement was authentic. And once again, VMG Valsal says that if you get to a trial, the claim is objectively reasonable. The Japanese and Chinese courts found that the agreement was authentic. The Thai court found otherwise.
Well, my understanding of when the district judge said, with regard to unreasonableness, recognized that, but regarded the whole summary judgment proceeding as, at least on the borderline of unreasonable.
Precisely, Your Honor, which is why I wanted to clear that issue away and get to the second issue, which is the reasonableness of the interpretation of the 1976 agreement. The 1976 agreement expressly refers to copyright as one of the rights that's being transferred. If, you know, that alone, absent the judge's ruling...
Right, but first of all, you had a determination by the Japanese court based on Japanese law that this isn't what the agreement meant. Whether that's preclusive or not preclusive, it's still a fairly consequential adverse fact.
Right? Yes, Your Honor. That takes us to the Berne Convention.
I'm sorry, what?
That takes us to the issue of the Berne Convention.
Why does it take us to the issue of the Berne Convention?
Because the under the Berne Convention and case law in the U.S., the copyright, the rights conveyed are determined under Japanese law. The scope of the rights that are interpreted under U.S. law.
And your version of that, to me, makes no sense, because this is a strict contract interpretation question. Then what is the reproduction right or the distribution right or whatever is determined under American law, but not whether the contract conveyed it? That's a contract question. It's not a copyright question.
Well, the contract, even under the district court's interpretation, conveyed the reproduction right. And okay. This is an issue that was alluded to, wasn't briefed as well as it could have been, but we have two rights in the bundle of rights that are implicated here. One is the reproduction right, 106.1.
Let's go back to what Judge Donato was saying. Let's suppose we agreed with the district court on his summary judgment ruling on the merits. If we were to, we don't have to reach it, but suppose we thought there's nothing wrong with his assessment of the fact that this, you had a weak argument on summary judgment. In other words, we look at it to that degree. Was your argument on summary judgment at least weak? Do we have to get to the rest of this?
Yes, I believe so, Your Honor, because if the...
We have to get in the fee-shifting context. I just don't get that. What case says you go back and review an interlocutory summary judgment order in order to determine where the fees are appropriately awarded under the Copyright Act?
Well, we have an appeal on that issue as well, but if the district court bases its ruling on a summary judgment order, and the district court is correct on the order, but is wrong about how strong the position or weak the position was of the party opposing fees, that issue still gets looked at.
In my view, the district court threw you a big bone because he didn't say you were entirely frivolous. A good case could be made the other way. So the judge very moderately said, okay, I'll give the benefit of the doubt to you, your client. I'm not going to throw the whole thing out as frivolous. I have my concerns. That's all that he said. He said, for example, all of the foreign courts found that the 1976 agreement did not transfer rights in new or derivative works. That is literally true. That's not something that the judge made a mistake on, even if you took your view of this fee-shifting issue, which I don't agree with. He wasn't wrong about it. The judgments literally say that. And on the basis of that, he said, okay, so I have some doubts now that this was a 100% above board action. There's a little bit of frivolity to it. That is the perfectly sound exercise of the broad discretion entrusted to the district judge by Congress.
If I may get back to the issue of the Berne Convention, as I was saying, there are two rights, the reproduction right, it's 106.1, and the right to make derivative works, 106.2. And as a matter of U.S. law, the reproduction right conveys the right to make copies. And it's not just the right to make verbatim copies, it also protects against substantial similarity.
Okay, but the judge, you went through this with the judge and he didn't see it your way, okay? So we're just talking about now, are you properly left holding the bill at least in part? That's what we're talking about. I don't find the Berne Convention references to be at all compelling for the copyright award of fees. I'm not seeing the connection, but can you just tell me why you think that the court abused its discretion in awarding the fees under the Copyright Act?
Well, we believe the court abused discretion by awarding the fees under the Copyright Act, primarily because it misweighed the strength of the arguments that UMC made, and GMG and Taiga didn't make these arguments at all. You know, we can get to the issue as to why the court awarded fees against those parties when they didn't make the arguments. But if the court isn't inclined to go with appellants on this issue, if the court is willing to find that the district court was completely correct, applied Article 61 to...
Counsel, that's not the test. Our test is, did the district judge abuse his discretion? That's the test. We are not doing a de novo review of summary judgment. This is what's troubling me. The test is, was the sound discretion of the district court misapplied? And you're telling me, well, he's wrong as a matter of law on the Berne Convention. That is not an argument on abuse of discretion.
Well, let's just go to the appeal on the summary from the summary judgment motion. That is de novo. And so these arguments that I make, the court will...
You lost the jury verdict. You don't even have a contract. Your contract was found to be non-existent. So what difference does the interpretation of a non-existent contract make?
Well, that's the other issue on appeal, which is on the merits of the whether or not the court erred by excluding evidence, and it sounds as if I ought to go to that issue
now. All right,
now
I'm confused. What are we arguing next? Are you arguing the evidentiary questions, or are you arguing the summary judgment motion? You said you were going to argue the summary judgment motion. We expressed some doubt as to whether that's before us.
Well,
are you going to argue it is before us, or are you going to go to the evidentiary questions?
Oh, it's certainly before the court, Your Honor. We took an appeal from the summary judgment order. It is here. And
why isn't it, counsel, why isn't it moot once the jury determines that there is no contract? That piece of the verdict, as I take it, is challenged only insofar as you allege there were evidentiary errors that were prejudicial that led to that verdict. But if we assume that verdict stands, why would we ever look at the summary judgment ruling that preceded it?
If the verdict stands, Your Honor, then we believe, there are apparently doubts about this, that you still need to look at the strength of the arguments that were raised with regard to that motion in order to evaluate the factors of objective reasonableness and frivolousness. And
But that's not a direct review of the summary judgment anymore. So if the verdict is valid, then the only role that's played by the summary judgment ruling, in your view, is how it plays into the exercise of discretion in the award of fees. Is that right?
That's correct, Your Honor. And I note it's a penumbral review, I believe, so that we can lose it on the summary judgment ruling and still win on objective reasonableness and non-frivolity. And that is the argument.
But then we don't reach the merits of the summary judgment motion.
That's precisely right, Charlie.
Okay, but you've been kind of wandering around as to whether you're saying we do or we don't. But do you want to get to the evidentiary issues at all or not?
Yes, I would, Your
Honor.
Okay,
then go ahead.
So turning to the evidentiary issues, the key issue at trial was the authenticity of the signature on the 1976 agreement, whether Noboru Tsuburaya signed the agreement. And we believe the district court abused its discretion in excluding testimony from a former TPC employee, Mr. Ugawa, that in 1998 in Thailand, he said there were thousands of signatures from Noboru, and we wanted to use evidence at trial that only a handful of signatures were considered by the handwriting experts. We believe the district court erroneously found that this evidence was irrelevant.
And why was it relevant when the handwriting expert said it wasn't relevant to him?
Well, to the extent that handwriting analysis is a science, and I kind of have doubts about this, it is based upon the premise that the handwriting analysts have enough signatures to see whether or not the signature falls within.
So my understanding is that he looked at, I think, 29 signatures, of which 10 were chosen by Gawa at some earlier point for some other reason. Is that basically right?
That's correct. And he considered a total of 8.
Even if there was something suspicious about those 10, which there's no strong indication there is, because it wasn't even for this purpose that they were being looked at, as I understand it, originally, when he chose them.
No, it was precisely this purpose. It was the exact issue of the authenticity of the 1976 agreement in proceedings in Japan.
I thought it was something completely else. Oh. But whichever, there were still 19 more. So what's the problem here?
The problem is you need a lot more signatures to say that someone never does something than that somebody does something.
But you have a handwriting expert who says he didn't. I mean, they can believe him or disbelieve him. You can cross-examine him about, which you did, about hypothetically, do you need more? Is this enough? And he says, oh, yes, it's definitely enough. So what's the problem?
Well, the problem is hypothetical is far different than the facts. The fact is there were thousands of signatures. Mr. Ogawa had every opportunity to look at those signatures and find ones that did not look like the signature on the 1976 agreement.
But then you would have to prove that up somehow. In other words, you were trying to imply that. You were trying to imply spoliation. And what the district court essentially held is that implication on a 403 analysis was prejudicial, given the very small probative value of this, given the fact because the expert said it had no probative value.
Well, let me just add to that. The district court found there was no evidence of spoliation, okay, and found, all things being considered, it was also prejudicial. Where is the abuse of discretion? I know you don't agree with it, but where is the abuse of discretion in that?
Actually, Your Honor, we agree with there's no spoliation, and the reason for that was there was no duty on the behalf of TPC back in the late 90s to preserve these signatures. We had a Japanese law expert who was going to testify to that until the court excluded that evidence. I'm not sure that a lay jury is going to assume spoliation, but let's take away any potential blame on TPC's part. Let's say there was a warehouse where the signatures were kept. There was a fire, and all the signatures got destroyed, except for the 29 that were reviewed by Mr. Cunningham. And then our argument was, well, these signatures were destroyed, and the signatures you looked at might not have been fully representative because there's all these other signatures out there you never got to look
at. Is it correct that 19 of the 29 signatures were not chosen by Mr. Ogawa?
It's correct that 8 of the signatures from the period 1970 through 1987 were not. There were later signatures that were looked at, and they were kind of scrawling, and they weren't representative, and the experts kind of disregarded them. But, the expert...
And you were trying to get in the former testimony of a deceased witness, okay? So there'd be no examination, no discussion, nothing would have happened in the court in the Central District of California to test any of that. And the judge, in my view, properly said that is a mile away from anything that's possibly probative, and I find that this is going to be something that's very likely going to confuse or mislead or baffle the jury. So it seems to me a perfectly sound ruling, and I didn't see any case law citation, by the way, in your brief suggesting the contrary. What case says this was an abuse of discretion? I didn't find one. Now maybe we missed it. I missed it, but you didn't have any.
No, I haven't seen cases that are directly on point. The Solner article.
Well, there's an awful lot of signature testimony, penmanship testimony in court. So if there was some need to tell for the jury to understand how many signatures there were out there in the world in order to properly evaluate the testimony, you'd think there'd be some case that would have discussed it. I mean, your basic proposition is that in order to evaluate this kind of testimony, you have to know that there were lots and lots of other signatures that were not looked at. That's your proposition.
No, not quite true.
Well, it has to be. What else is your proposition?
That's part of the proposition. The other part of the proposition is that party claiming there can't be an opportunity to cherry pick. The Solner article that we cited,
that argument you might have if all of them were cherry picked, but the majority of them weren't.
In the relevant time period,
you've designated
many of them, and there. If the court looks at the styles of signatures, there are actually a couple of different styles of signatures. There's N Tsuburaya signatures. There's no Boru Tsuburaya signatures. Mr. Cunningham didn't consider the N Tsuburaya signatures. In his direct comparisons, he looked at them and he said, well, they don't have Noboru written out. And so the number of signatures he actually looked at that were Noboru Tsuburaya were considerably less than
that. You have plenty of room on cross-examination to tell the jury all this.
Your Honor, Mr. Cunningham didn't come
But
to
you have plenty of room to examine the expert. What more did you need? By the way, the thing that troubles me in this case, you had the gold standard witness. You had the one living man who could have said, I saw Noboru sign this document, and he didn't show up. I mean, and you want to backhoe all of this with all of the, dead witness testimony and tied transcripts. I don't think you can show that this was in any way abuse of discretion on the court to control this this sort of uncontrolled volume of overseas evidence and deceased witnesses. I just don't see it.
Okay, I seem to be just about out of time. There's more I'd like to go through, but with the court's indulgence.
Well, you'll have a minute in rebuttal, so thank you very much.
But I'll ask the court if the court has other questions based upon the briefing rather than trying
based
to...
Based upon what? I'm sorry?
Other questions that would like to ask me and that I can respond to.
Well, I don't have any right now, so thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Good morning, and may it please the court. I am Dan Posner for the appellee, Tsuburaya. I agree with the concerns that the court expressed during Mr. Wexler's argument, and I'd like to direct my argument to any concerns that the court has with our position.
What about on the fee question?
Yes.
Do we have to evaluate the summary judgment ruling to the degree, if we're going to review the question of whether the reasonableness and frivolity evaluations, which were largely based on the summary judgment aspect of the case, are an abuse of discretion? We at least need to stick our toe into the question to some degree.
It certainly doesn't require a full review of summary judgment per se. The judge...
Well, if, for example, we thought that the district judge was incorrect in his summary judgment ruling, then we would have to think he was incorrect as to the reasonableness, wouldn't we?
It's a very different...
And I'm not only incorrect, but an abuse of discretion. If he were wrong,
sure,
then he would have abused his discretion on the unreasonableness. Is that right?
Well, no, I don't believe
Why?
So, because it's a totality of the circumstances test under Kurtzang and many other cases.
Ordinarily, a mistake of law is an abuse of discretion. That's what the Supreme Court said in Kuhn. And so if the summary judgment were legally erroneous, why wouldn't we take that into account in determining whether there was an abuse of discretion in evaluating the parties' positions?
I think the court very well could take that into account.
So therefore, we have to look at the summary judgment decision
I'm sorry to interrupt. It's not a de novo review of summary judgment as it would be in their appeal of summary judgment.
Well, but in a way it is, because if the conclusion is that it was legally, do we have to at least look to whether it was legally incorrect? And because summary judgment is always a legal ruling, because we don't decide, there's no underlying factual determination, then it seems to me that logically, although I find, Judge Donato's proposition that we don't have to do this appealing, we have a lot to do here, I'm not exactly sure how we avoid doing it, because if we concluded that it was legally incorrect, I don't see how it could be how we could sustain the unreasonableness finding.
Under an abuse of discretion standard, it would be appropriate to look at summary judgment among the many other facets of the case that the district court addressed in its order, finding that fees were appropriate.
But that is basically what it addressed in the unreasonableness finding, pretty much, and in the frivolity. It was pretty much only the summary judgment ruling.
In the frivolity and unreasonable standard, I believe the district court took a fair, full view of the case, but did focus on positions that were decided and resolved on summary judgment.
Right. If you could help me to understand why we don't have to decide whether his ruling was legally wrong. Because if it was legally wrong, he was wrong about whether it was unreasonable.
I'm not saying that there's not a relevance to the summary judgment on this appeal. It's a different standard. It's not a de novo review. It's a question of whether the judge abused its discretion for purposes of the fees by deciding that certain positions that UMC took that made its way into the summary judgment ruling were wrong to the point of being unreasonable and frivolous. And we certainly...
And if they were right, then they certainly weren't wrong to the degree of being unreasonable or frivolous.
I'm sorry?
And if they were right, then they weren't wrong to the degree of being unreasonable and frivolous.
Well, likely so, but they were not right, and I'm happy
okay,
to talk
so
about that.
Okay, so therefore we have to... All right, well, go ahead.
But let me suggest a possible answer to Judge Berzon's question. If the jury verdict stands, the summary judgment is irrelevant. Wouldn't it be irrelevant for fee-shifting purposes as well?
Well, if the jury verdict stands, the summary judgment ruling is certainly irrelevant to the merits of UMC's appeal, because as Your Honor noted, there is no need to interpret the meaning of a contract that has been determined to be an invalid.
Let me put a finer point on it. If the contract that your opponent was standing on is found to be non-existent, isn't that the very definition of frivolousness?
Absolutely, Your Honor. And in that case...
So in other words, if we sustain the authenticity verdict, there's just no question that this was potentially at least a partially frivolous action.
If the contract is determined, as it was by the jury, to be a forged contract, there is simply no reason to wade into the question of what that contract means for purposes
of the merits of the case. Well, that's not my question. We can sustain the fee award as well without going into summary judgment.
Yes, Your Honor.
You see what I'm saying?
Yes, I do. Okay. And I agree with that.
All right.
But is that what the district court did? No. The district court did not base the unreasonable signing on, he didn't find that the position as to the existence of the contract was unreasonable or frivolous, did he?
It's not clear that the district court did. The district court certainly focused on the positions that made themselves into the summary judgment rulings,
right,
which were the unreasonable and frivolous positions that UM Corporation took in arguing that the district court here should interpret this contract in a manner wholly different from the interpretations that were reached multiple times by the Japanese courts as embodied in multiple final judgments.
Think it's very important to be true to the record here. He did not say these were frivolous. He said they were weak. There were serious questions raised because of the other foreign courts that said no to this in, I think, two or maybe even three other countries. All the judge said was, this is not a very good claim. He did not say this is baseless, this is outrageous, this is bad. He didn't say any of that. He doesn't have to, in my view, under Fogarty. He just has to assess the case on the totality of circumstances and say this is appropriate to shift fees.
And I think that's absolutely right, Your Honor. And even after the Kurtzsang case, which recognized that district courts must consider objective unreasonableness of the losing party's position, that court also recognized that it may still be appropriate to award fees in certain cases, even where the losing party's position is reasonable.
It said just consider. In other words, look at it. It doesn't say you have to find it.
Correct.
That's a really big difference. And I think your opponent is suggesting, you must have a fine. You don't. It's not my reading of the Kurtzsang. You have to consider it. You can't just, it would be an abuse of discretion not to consider it and award fees. But you can consider it and say, it's close to the line, but that should be enough.
I think that's not only a fair reading of Kurtzsang, I think that's precisely what it says in a couple occasions, that reasonableness should be considered. Fees can be awarded even without a finding of unreasonableness. It's a totality of the circumstances test. And there's a number of factors here that tipped very strongly in our favor. The district court had every right to balance the entire case and decide that certain factors tipped slightly in our favor.
Which ones tipped very strongly in your favor?
Certainly the purposes of the Copyright Act, whether this victory served and promoted the purposes.
That's the main one. That's the only one, probably.
Well, success on the merits is also an important factor, which tipped very strongly in our favor. We defeated two motions for summary judgment in this case. Well, we defeated UMC's motion. We prevailed on our own motion. We prevailed at trial. We defeated post-trial motions. That's substantial success. And I would add on the factor of promoting the purposes of the Copyright Act. Of course, the purpose of the Copyright Act is to promote the creation of artistic and original works. This was not simply a case where Tsuburaya was trying to stop an infringer from infringing on its Ultraman rights. Tsuburaya, in this case, was fighting for its very right to distribute its own Ultraman works in the United States, because that's what UM Corporation put at stake by filing this lawsuit. And by prevailing...
And isn't it true every overseas court said that's the one thing you can't do?
Absolutely. Every overseas court to evaluate the meaning of the contract has interpreted the contract narrowly. And if they found it authentic at all.
The Japanese courts did more than once. Did the Chinese and Thai courts also say that?
The Thai courts found the contract to be invalid altogether.
Right.
The Chinese courts largely followed the Japanese judgment, which makes a lot of sense because it's a Japanese judgment interpreting a Japanese contract under Japanese law, which is what the district court did here. And it sounds like there might be some issue or some need to address or wade into the summary judgment issue for some purpose in this case. So I'll point out...
At least one of us doesn't think so, but go ahead.
Well, I've got some time left.
I have actually a different question. If you're looking for answers, if you're looking for things to talk about, you agree that the costs, the shifting gears, you agree the costs have to be given up, right?
Yes, Your Honor. We agree that in light of the Rimini Street case, the award of non-taxable costs is not warranted.
And you also agree there's no remand. We're just going to, if we see it, if we all agree, we just reverse that and we don't remand for any reason.
That's fine, Your Honor. I was going to offer to work with UM Corporation to effect a change to the judgment, but if the court wants to do it itself, I think that would be even more efficient.
So stipulated. Okay.
So basically, that $500,000 plus, is that what it is?
Yeah.
Backs out, and the district judge already backed out $150,000 or $60,000 for the affirmative summary judgment, the affirmative copyright.
That's correct. The district court found that to be a generous approximation of the amount of fees that Tsuburaya spent pursuing its counterclaims for copyright infringement because we were not eligible to recover fees on those claims and those claims only because of the timing of when we registered the work. UM Corporation doesn't disagree with the amount of that reduction, so there's no question that it was appropriate reduction.
Well, of the evidentiary issues, if you want to talk about one of them, I am pretty interested in the work product issue.
The work product issue. Well, I'll start by saying there's no dispute here that the document is attorney work product. At least UM Corporation doesn't challenge that on appeal. And so UMC is only entitled to it if it can show a substantial need. And I think an important point to make is that under Federal Rule of Civil Procedure 26, it's not simply a substantial need for the notes to prove a point or to impeach a witness. It's a substantial need for the notes to prepare its case. And these notes, UMC simply did not have that type of substantial need for them because Mr. Morishima, the subject of the interview, was alive and well. He was able to testify at deposition in Japan. He testified at trial. And there was plenty of evidence to address the issues that he addressed in his interview about the authenticity of the contract under an abuse of
discretion. But he said that he'd never seen this document until 1998. And these notes were from 1996. Is that right?
The interview was allegedly conducted in 1996 when Mr. Sompote, around the time that he brought the document to Tsuburaya's attention for the first time, which was 20 years after it was allegedly signed and just months after the alleged signator of the document, Mr. Noboru Tsuburaya, had died.
I understand all that. But in terms of if you want to impeach Morishima, as to what he was saying, and he says, I didn't see this till 1998, why isn't it of some importance to be able to demonstrate that he actually saw it in 96, and when he saw it in 96, he said something different than what he's saying now?
I don't think it's of any relevance to point out whether
Maybe I misunderstood the record. I thought Mr. Morishima said the meeting didn't take place in 96. He didn't say anything. He just said the meeting, he wasn't sure the meeting happened in 1996. And he didn't know that until it got refreshed in 1998 or something like that. But he wasn't flat out denying the proposition that he was being asked about.
That's correct, Your Honor. He didn't recall giving that interview in 1996, and unfortunately...
But I thought the reason he said he knew it wasn't in 1996 because he didn't see this document until 98.
That is what he testified.
That's what he said,
He recalled seeing it for the first time in 1998, and he was able to testify to his views on the authenticity of the document.
They had plenty of room to cross-examine, roast him, whatever they wanted to do without getting the work product.
And I'll make this point, too. At the time he was allegedly shown this document in 1996, this was 20 years after he had left the company. He had not worked with Mr. Noboru Tsuburaya or for the company for 20 years. And so allegedly a document was placed in front of him and he was asked, what are your thoughts on this? There's far more authoritative evidence and direct evidence in the record regarding those issues than what Mr. Morishima allegedly said in 1996.
So you're basically making a harmlessness argument as to that.
Well, that's a whole other story that I'm happy to go into. It's absolutely a harmless error. And we feel, as a big picture issue, there's certainly no abuse of discretion, but there's plainly no prejudice. The question of prejudice is evaluated by looking at the record as a whole and the evidence as a whole. And I feel that UM Corporation focuses solely on inferences that potentially could be drawn from these individual items of evidence if they were to be introduced without at all addressing whether it's actually more probable than not that this jury would have found the 1976 document to be authentic rather than a forgery had any of these items of evidence been introduced.
Did their brief discuss the authenticity issue at all? I mean, the prejudice issue at all?
I think they discuss it in an erroneous way by simply stating this is a piece of evidence that we argue has some relevance, therefore there's prejudice.
But not in terms of the entire record.
That's absolutely right, Your Honor. And we summarize that evidence at pages 13 to 15 of our red merits brief. I think the district court did a nice job summarizing it as well at ER 10 in his order on the motion for a trial.
I think you're being a little shy about work product. That means something. That work product means, not attorney clients, not that sacrosanct, but it means something. And you've got to have a showing about why you should invade that attorney space to get work product. Well, and just because it would be nice to have, which is effectively my view of UMC's argument, and I'm not even sure it would be nice to have given the case as a whole, that's not enough. Particularly when you have a live witness that you can ask any question you want of in court before the jury.
I think that's exactly right. I didn't state the full rule. Federal Rule of Civil Procedure 26B3A2 is what sets the standard for showing.
What worries me, I see work product erosions happening all the time, and I think it's pernicious. And I think this is a good example of, this would be handy to have, so we can just trump work product. That's not the test. Work product means something.
It's not the test, and there's been no authority offered by UM Corporation that would support the production of a work product document under any comparable circumstances.
You don't have to keep going if you have
Unless the court has any further questions about the fees issue, the evidentiary issues, or summary judgment issue, I thank you very much for your time.
Thank you very much. I have 1 minute. Thank you.
Turning briefly to the work product issue, these were notes taken by a non-attorney, sent to an attorney 2 weeks later, apparently. We haven't seen the cover memo. Don't know whether these notes were taken at the request of the attorney, whether they were sent there afterwards. I can't talk about the content of the notes.
Wait a moment. You conceded in your brief this is work product. Now you're suggesting there are questions. I don't think that's playing a little fast and loose. You said in your brief, there's no dispute this is work product. On page 41, this is not the time to backtrack on that.
That's correct, Your Honor. It's just when
you're starting to say things, we didn't really see an attorney's name. Those are questions about whether it's work product. That's not right.
Thank you, Your Honor. When you're talking about erosion of work product, I just want to make it clear that this is not somewhere in the core of work product.
You said it was attorney work product. Can't backtrack on that now.
Well, it's work product. It is qualified work product. It's not absolute attorney work product. And I can't talk about what's in that, but the highlighted portions in our brief, pages 10 or 11, if the jury heard what was said there and believe that, rather than what Mr. Morishima said 20 years after the interview, which he didn't recall that interview in 1996. In 1998, when he said he saw it, it was not an interview by Mr. Ugawa. He was shown it by Sampo, he said. He had no recollection whatsoever. The cases we cite say that where a witness has a faulty memory, no one disputes that work. It's appropriate to show work product. Very briefly, Judge Donato, with regard to your point that if the verdict is affirmed, then there's no substantial question that it's a potentially frivolous action. VMG Valsal says that if you get to a jury on a claim, it's not frivolous. If you say it's frivolous because a party ultimately loses, then you're getting rid of all the other factors. You're just collapsing. You're just making the prevailing party entitled to fees. So you would need to be.
I agree with all of that. All I'm saying is your client, not you, but your client had three other courts say the same thing, and this is the fourth bite at the same apple. And at that point, seems to me the frivolousness argument takes on a different tone.
Not that thing, Your Honor. What the court did at trial, we lost before that jury, that was an issue that our client or its predecessor won in Japan and China.
And the district judge said in the fees order that that was not unreasonable or frivolous.
Precisely, Your Honor.
Okay, fine. But he said other things were unreasonable and frivolous.
Or might be. It's kind of wishy-washy as to what the court was saying or not saying. It's on the one hand, on the other hand, maybe this, maybe that.
You say wishy-washy. That's the whole point of a balancing inquiry. You say on the one hand, on the other hand, and then you draw up a tally at the end. That's not wishy-washy. That's giving you the benefit of every factor.
I think
that's in your interest as the party left holding the bill.
I think that there's a need to come to a conclusion on the factors, not just saying, well, you could go this way, you could go that way, and then just throwing everything into the balance. The purpose of the Fogarty factors is to cabin the discretion of the court. And if the court is not making determinations on each of the factors, rather than just, you know, spelling it all out and then coming out at the end and saying, oh, well, I'm going to award fees, then discretion hasn't been cabined.
The cases are very clear that discretion is not a checklist.
The cases, we believe, Your Honor, are also...
May consider. You're not bound to make a ruling on everything.
No, I believe on the Fogarty factors, the court, you don't need to find everything on those factors in order to award fees, certainly, but I think the court is supposed to consider the Fogarty factors along with others and say how it's coming out in each of the factors.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Your Honor.
The case of UM Corporation versus Tsuburaya Productions is submitted.